Honest, real, raw, true conversation and prayer with God.
You go down into the water, and when you do, the old person dies. You come up out of the water as a new creation in Jesus Christ.
Hey, welcome to Church Experience. Thank you so much for spending part of your weekend with us. Now is a great time to grab your weeklies and head to your seats if you haven't already, because the service starts in 90 seconds.
I'm here to tell you today that God wants to set you free.
Oh, yeah.
He wants to set you free.
Pursue a relationship with Him. Grow in your walk with Him. Get closer to Him. Spend more time with Him because He's better. If you want your life to get better, then get around the one who is better. Get around Jesus. Get around the one who has power to change and transform your life. Get around the one who has the perfect grace for you and the perfect love for you and the perfect joy for your soul. Listen, He is better.
Welcome to CE Online. Thank you so much for spending time with us today. We are so excited about today's service. We believe this could be the best and most impacting hour of your week.
Throughout the service, you may have some questions, comments, or prayer requests. If so, go to churchexperience.tv/connect or pull out your camera app and hit up our QR code to connect with us. Or better yet, if you've always wanted to know what's going on here at CE, just hit that subscribe button right here.
We'd love to hear from you, get back to you, and be praying for you. We are ready to dive in. Would you stand with me as we sing some songs of worship to Jesus?
Great.
Is the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are. We claim your victory. Let it so great, Jesus in all things. I've seen a glimpse of your heart a billion years. Still I'll be singing. How can I praise you enough? How can I praise you enough?
Lord, we just praise you today. We praise you for meeting us where we are. And Lord, just showing us that true love, just that never-ending love, and showing us how to love, Lord. And we just give thanks for you and all that you've done for us. And it's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Well, this morning we are continuing our series called Like You. And in this series, we are trying to learn how we could be more like Jesus. What are the qualities, what are the characteristics that Jesus has that we can try to imitate in our lives so that we could be more like Him? So the first week, we talked about the great quality of Jesus' love for us. I mean, He loved us so much that He sacrificed His life for us. And we realize that love was supposed to be reciprocal, that God gives us that love and then expects us to give that love back to Him and back to our fellow men. So if people want to look at us and see us looking like Jesus, the first thing we have to do is show that kind of love to the people around us. Then the second week, we talked about the great quality of Jesus' humility. You know, Jesus was part of the Trinity, part of the Godhead Himself, but it says not
considering equality something to be grasped, but rather he took on the form of a servant. That was the kind of humility that Jesus showed. And if we are going to let people see Jesus living in us, we're going to have to leave our pride at the door and put on that kind of humility, right? Well, this week we're going to take a look at a third characteristic of Jesus. And if people can see this characteristic in us, they can see Jesus living in us as well. And that characteristic is the quality of compassion. Compassion. Do you have compassion in your life like Jesus did? Do you have the kind of compassion that you see a need and it causes you to feel a certain way to the point where it forces you to do something about it? You see, that's the kind of compassion that Jesus had, and that's the kind of compassion that God expects from us. So let me ask you this question. How much do you really care, have compassion for maybe the person standing next to you in the checkout line at the grocery store? Or how much do you really care about that one particular neighbor in your neighborhood that nobody else likes and everybody talks bad about? What kind of compassion do you show them? And maybe that person is you, I don't know. Or what kind of compassion do you feel for people that are lost in their sin? You see, Jesus exhibited what kind of compassion he would show in each of those situations. What about yourselves? So today's text that we're going to use to take a look at this idea of compassion comes out of Luke chapter 10. And this story is really the first century equivalent of what's going on all around our world today. And it just boggles my mind that in this 21st century, we are still dealing with things like racism and equality and those sort of things. Jesus was very clear that when we become in Christ, we become one in Christ. There's no longer Jew nor Greek, slave nor free. We all become one. And yet still today, there are groups that think that we are the chosen people and the other people are below us and we're not on equal footing. So the story we're going to look at today shows this isn't a new idea. This has been going on even back in the time of the Bible. It's a familiar story. You've all heard it before. It's the story of the Good Samaritan. And it's told actually in response to a question that was asked of Jesus by a Jewish lawyer. Now, this wasn't the kind of lawyer tried trials. Or did that kind of lawyer work. He was actually a person that was a professor. He was an expert of the law. He knew the law inside and outside. And in this question that he's going to ask Jesus, actually his motive for that was to try to catch Jesus off guard and let Jesus know, hey, I know the law better than you know the law. And I just can't imagine anybody thinking they're going to catch Jesus off guard or that they're going to know something more than Jesus knows. But this is what he did. So in verse 25, it says, on one occasion, an expert of the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, we're told he's a lawyer. He's not the kind of lawyer that we talked about. He's this Old Testament scholar. And the question asked of Jesus by this lawyer basically is, you know, what do I have to do to get eternal life? What must I do to be saved? Kind of like the rich young ruler asked Jesus in the book of Matthew, what must I do in order to have eternal life? And basically what he's trying to ask is, you know, tell me what the law says, what rules I have to follow, that if I follow these rules, then I'll have eternal life. And I can just kind of see Jesus chuckling. You know, this guy thinks he's got me. He's asking me this question. But Jesus doesn't answer the question. Instead, he just throws the question back in the lawyer's lap. And in verse 26, he says, well, what's written in the law? You're the expert. You tell me. How do you read it? So Jesus doesn't give him an answer. He says, you know the law. What does it say? So in verse 27, he said, well, the law says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, you have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. So Jesus asked the question. The man gives him an answer. And Jesus responds by saying, good answer. Now do it. Now, some people are troubled by this answer that Jesus gave, because we need to understand Jesus is not saying that you are saved by the law. He doesn't say, okay, here's what the law says, and if you follow these points of the law, then you will be saved. He is reminding the man what the law says, because the law requires that you have to keep all the law, that you have to be perfect in keeping the law. There can't be any omissions. You can't leave anything out. There can't be any failures. One little failure, and the whole thing is no good. Kind of reminds me of when you got your driver's license as a teenager. I don't know what's wrong with teenagers these days. We were so anxious to get ours that the day I turned 16, I'm knocking on the door down there at 7 a.m. to let me in so I could take my test. Today, I hear teenagers are waiting until 19, 20. Ah, we'll do it when we want to. I don't get it. I was ready to drive. But you go down there and you take that driving test, and you try to do everything perfectly. Got the blinkers on, and you're looking both ways and everything, and the guy's sitting over there with the little clipboard, just waiting for one thing he can write down. And he feels like he hasn't done his job if he hasn't written down at least one thing, right? You know what I did wrong? I didn't turn the car off when we were finished. That's what he wrote down. But I learned it's impossible to keep every law. It's just impossible. So Jesus tells him, you know what? Yeah, you do those things and you know, you'll be saved. That's a good answer. Now go do it, knowing that it's impossible to do. So the Old Testament lawyer did what lawyers do so well, and he tried to find a loophole. So in verse 29, he wants to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, okay, if I'm supposed to love my neighbor as myself, who is my neighbor? Now, why did the neighbor ask this question like this? Luke says he wanted to justify himself, that he wanted to make himself seem right in his relationship with God. See, the lawyer was measuring himself against both commands, loving God and loving his neighbor. And he felt like, well, you know, I got the first one down pretty good. I know that God is God, and I love him with all my heart, my mind, my soul, my strength, and all that sort of thing. I'm pretty good on that one. So what about this second one, about loving your neighbor as yourself? So he's measuring himself, and he's trying to define what his neighbor is. He's asking who and how much do I have to love in order to have eternal life? And a lot of times in our life, we're like that lawyer, where we try to reduce God's commands down to something that we can live with. We see that God's command says this, and it makes us uncomfortable, and we really like to do this, so how can we reword his command or water it down a little bit to where we can feel comfortable with what he's telling us to do? We'd like to believe that loving our neighbor means loving people who love us, right? That we could do that. Or maybe we can love people who are lovable. You know, we can do that. Loving my neighbor, therefore, comes to mean doing nice things for people who will probably do nice things for me. I can do that. And that's probably what the lawyer was thinking here. So the lawyer's original question was, what do I have to do to get in? But Jesus' question to him actually is, what does a person look like that's already in? And he was totally unprepared for Jesus' story about compassion that he was about to share with him. So this morning, we're going to take a look at this story and see that there are five basic lessons that concern compassion in our lives. So let's take a look at those five things. Is that okay? Oh, you want seven? Five? Five is okay? Okay, five. Five it is. Here's the first one. Compassion is based on need, not worth. When you feel compassion for someone, you should feel compassion because of what the need is, not what the person is worth that has a need. In verse 33, it says, or in verse 30, it says that a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, and they beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. Or as Billy Crystal said in Princess Bride, mostly dead there. And you look at this verse, you say, that's old-fashioned. People don't, you know, strip people of their clothes anymore and rob them and beat them. But I just read an article a few weeks ago about people that had this certain snow jacket that became very popular. And when they go to visit New York City, they're getting beaten up and their snow jackets are being stolen. I'm like, well, wonder why? And then I found out those jackets cost $2,500. And then you know why. But people are still stealing clothes today. You put really nice tennis shoes on kids and they go to school and they come home without their shoes. And the parents say, what happened to your shoes? Well, they stole them from me. Because people see things and they want them. And that was happening way back then. This guy's walking down the road. Robbers see him. They strip him of his clothes. They beat him and they leave him half dead. Now, our compassion is to be driven not by the worth of that individual, but by the need of that individual. Here Jesus says, a certain man. He didn't describe who he was or where his place was on the status of life. Today we would probably just say some guy. Some guy was walking down the road. But this man is robbed and he's wounded and he's left for dead. He needs help in the worst way. As the unknown victim lay beside the road, half dead, a series of three individuals come along the way. And this first passerby is introduced in verse 31. It says, a priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. Now, many people over the years have excused this priest for passing by, because they say the priest probably thought the guy was dead, and that would have made the priest unclean, and he wouldn't have been able to carry out his duties in the temple that day. But I want you to notice that it said both he and the Levite later were coming down the road. That means they were coming from Jerusalem to Jericho. They'd already done their duties for the day. So he didn't have to worry about that at all. This is one of the most shocking aspects of the parable, because the priest was considered the holiest person there was amongst the Jews. He was taught the scriptures. He was entrusted with offering sacrifices for the sins of the people. He was allowed to go further into the temple than the regular people were allowed to go. If there was anybody that was going to reflect the character of God, it would be the priest, wouldn't it? And then the second passerby is introduced in verse 32. So too, a Levite. When he came to the place where he saw him, he passed by on the other side. The Levite at least went over to look at the man. And maybe that was similar to the practice today we have of rubbernecking, you know, where there's a terrible accident on the road and it's way over on the shoulder, but everybody's going slow. Why are they going so slow? It's because everybody's slowing down to look to see what happened over there. And maybe this Levite happens by and he slowed down to look what was happening over there. But still, he went to the other side of the road. And like all too many of us today, these first two passerbyers probably just didn't want to get involved. You know, there's a lot of different reactions people have when bad things happen or where there's a need. I watched a video a couple of weeks ago about that earthquake that happened over in the Middle East. And you watch this building just collapse. And you saw some people take off, run in the opposite direction as fast as they could go. You found other people that just stood there frozen, didn't know what to do. And there were some other people that ran right towards the building to see how they could help. Which of those three do you think showed compassion? You know, and you never know what kind of reaction you're going to have when something like that happens. But if we're going to have people see Jesus living in us, if we are going to be like him, we need to be the people that are running towards the people in need. The passage says that when these first two people went by, they just went on today. Now, both of these men saw the man. There's no doubt that they didn't see him. They saw that there was a need there, but they both ignored the need. And these two religious professionals were caught up in a lifeless religion. They played at church, but it didn't affect the way they live. You know, does your faith just play at church, or does it reflect a relationship with God? You see, compassion is based not on the worth of the individual, but on the need the individual has. Here's the second thing we learn about compassion. Compassion feels something. Compassion feels something. In verse 33, but a Samaritan, as he traveled, came to where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. That's another word for compassion. And it would have been shocking for Jesus to have told the people that, and the third man came along, and this was just an ordinary man. It wasn't a religious professional, and an ordinary man stopped to help. They'd have thought, wow, you know, just an ordinary guy did it. But Jesus didn't even talk about a Jew helping a Jew. Rather, he was talking about a Samaritan helping a Jew that had been ignored by his fellow Jews. And given the mutual hatred that there was between the Samaritans and the Jews of that day, it would have been more likely that the Samaritan stopped to finish off the job and to kill him than to help him at all. But today we call this story the parable of the Good Samaritan. In fact, the very phrase Good Samaritan has become part of our common language. But it definitely was not a phrase that was used by the Jews in Jesus' day. In fact, they couldn't consider the word good and Samaritan to belong in the same sentence. But the passage tells us that when the Samaritan saw him, he had compassion. And the Greek word for compassion there is a very vivid one. It comes from a word that refers to the intestines or the bowels. That's kind of gross, but it's equivalent of what we mean when we talk about having a gut feeling. A gut feeling is one that comes from the deepest part of who we are. And the Samaritan saw the same pitiful man lying in agony along the road that the other two saw, but his heart churned for him, so much so that he couldn't pass by without helping. See, that's the way compassion affects us. It stirs us. It troubles us. It keeps us awake at night until we do something about it. And when that Samaritan looked at that suffering man laying half dead on the side of the road, something happened in his gut, something that made it impossible for him to just walk away. You see, he didn't decide to help this guy based on how worthy he was. He stopped to help him based on how needy he was, and he was in obvious need. There's no logical reason for a Samaritan to rearrange his plans or to spend his money to help an enemy in need. Of all the people that passed by this injured man, the Samaritan had the least reason to stop and help. He was of no account in his society. Doing this good deed wasn't going to change his status in the community. But compassion sees a need and he feels something about it. And that leads us to the third point we learn about compassion. Compassion not only feels something, but compassion does something. It doesn't do any good to walk by and say, oh man, that's a shame. That must have really hurt. That's going to leave a mark. It doesn't do any good if you don't stop and try to help at all, does it? Compassion does something. So not only was a Samaritan's compassion based on the need rather than the worth, but it caused him to feel something so deeply that he expressed that need in action. In verse 34, we're told, he went to him and he bandaged his wounds. He poured on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey. He brought him to an inn and he took care of him. He doesn't pass by on the other side. He moved towards the injured man. You have to move towards someone to express compassion in order to build relationships with them. And it doesn't just mystically happen. It takes a concerted effort for that to happen. And often it's not convenient. But I don't want you to forget that this Samaritan is moving towards someone who, if that person was conscious, probably would despise him and would not do the same for him if the shoe was on the other foot. But Jesus details in these verses a series of six verbs on the action that this man's conscience led him to take care of. It says, he went to him, he bandaged his wounds, he poured oil and wine on his wounds, he put him on his donkey, he brought him to an inn, and he took care of him. In every one of these six acts, he demonstrated compassion as he responded in a practical, timely, an unselfish way. He put him on his own donkey. What does that mean? It means he's going to have to walk, right? I mean, the road to Jericho from Jerusalem to Jericho is long, and he had a donkey, so he didn't have to walk, but he put this man on the donkey. Now he has to walk. I mean, that's compassion right there. And it's important to recognize that he took time to take care of him. You know, a lot of us are happy to hand somebody a sandwich that's hungry or are happy to give them a bottle of water if they're thirsty, but please don't ask us for our time. You know, we value our time too much. In fact, in a couple of weeks, we're having Serve Our City here over in the other building. There's some things to sign up on how you can serve people. And you say, man, that's a Saturday. I've got so much to do. I don't want to give my time to do something like that. But true compassion sees that there's a need. And even though you're busy, you find the time to meet that need. So compassion, that doesn't only feel something, compassion does something. And that brings us to the next point about compassion. Because of that, sometimes compassion costs something. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said. And when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense that you might have. Now, this man really went the extra mile here, didn't he? He took this man to an inn. He saw to it he was taken care of. He paid for that care. He says, I'm going to come back tomorrow. If there's anything that you had to do that wasn't covered by the money I gave you, I'll reimburse you for that. He showed his compassion for this man. Compassion costs something. And that brings us to the last point about compassion. Compassion demonstrates our relationship with God. You see, if we have a good relationship with God, where we realize how he poured out his compassion on us, and we have that good relationship with him, it's just a natural byproduct for us to pour out our compassion on other people. But if we don't have a good relationship with him, it doesn't make sense to stop and hurt the needy person, because maybe whoever beat up that person is still there, and they might hurt us. You know, today it's hard for people to get involved and maybe break up fights or something like that, because everybody's got guns out there and you're afraid of that. But if you got compassion for people, you're going to step in there even if it costs you something. The conclusion of his story, the lawyer asks one more question in verse 36. He says, which of these do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? Rhetorical question. It's a pretty easy answer, right? Out of these three guys, which one of them do you think showed compassion? Well, this lawyer is choking on his words here. He can't bring himself to say the word Samaritan. So instead, in verse 37, he says, well, the one that showed mercy on him, that's the one. And for the second time, Jesus tells this man to do something in order to inherit eternal life. When this verse continues with Jesus saying to him, go and do likewise. Be like the Samaritan. Why does Jesus say this? Because he realizes that this man is never going to turn to him for salvation if he thinks that following the law is going to get him there first. And Jesus is pointing out that it's impossible for you to follow the law, and the only way you're ever going to get there is to have a relationship with me, and that relationship is shown through the compassion that you show to other people. This lawyer is left without any excuses, without any kind of vindication that he wanted. He thought that he was going to get Jesus with this question. But the second question that he asked, well, who is my neighbor, really got turned around on him to the question of what kind of neighbor are you? Are you the kind of neighbor that's just going to walk by on the other side of the road? Are you the kind of neighbor that's going to show compassion by seeing something and feeling something and doing something that might cost you something? In 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 through 18, surely one of the most convicting passages in the Bible, it says, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother and sister in need but does not have pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and truth. If you have what somebody needs and they're in dire need, and you say, boy, I sure hope you know you get that taken care of, and you don't take action, you don't have compassion in your life. You don't have the love of God in your life. James, in his Practical Principles for Living in the book of James, writes in James chapter 2, suppose a brother or sister is without clothes or daily food. If one of you says to them, well, you know, go in peace, keep warm, be well fed, but doesn't do anything about their physical needs, what good is that? If you've got 2 Big Macs and somebody's hungry and you say, boy, I sure hope you find something to eat, God bless you, and you walk away with 2 Big Macs, You haven't done anything, have you? Except make them mad, probably. That's what true compassion is. Compassion demonstrates whether we have a relationship with God. You see, in this story, Jesus is separating the person who has a real relationship with God from the person who is merely religious. And we saw what the religious folks did when they saw the man beaten and battered by the side of the road. They moved on. They kept walking. They crossed the street. And today we realize that we still have hate, and we still have violence, and we still have prejudice and all kinds of hurt going on all around us, and many people are still passing by on the other side of the street. We hear those stories, and like this Good Samaritan story, we say, well, how could they possibly do that? What kind of human being is that? And yet we witness people in need every day, and we keep walking. We may not have much, but we have something, and we're able to help the person that's right in front of us. Remember the old story about the two guys walking down the beach, and the beach was just covered in starfish? And the guy would walk and he'd pick one up and he'd throw it in the water, and they'd walk farther and talk, and he'd bend down and pick another one up and throw it in the water. And the guy says, what are you doing? He goes, well, these starfish are going to cook in the sun up here. They'll all die unless I throw them back in the water. He says, there's thousands of starfish out here. How could you possibly make a difference? And he picks the next one up and he says, it makes a difference to this one, and throws it back in the water. We can't possibly reach every starfish ourselves, can we? But we can reach the one that's right in front of us, and we can make a difference in their life. And that's only going to happen if we share the compassion that Christ had for us with other people. How do we do that? To show compassion means that it's based on need, not on worth. It means that you feel something, that you do something about it, that it's going to cost you when you do, and that it demonstrates your relationship to God. We all want to be more like Jesus, don't we? We want people to be able to look at us and say, you know what, that person is just like Jesus. We see the compassion that Jesus had for every one of us. And if people are going to see Jesus living in us, then we're going to have to show that same kind of compassion to them. We have to love. We have to care. We have to feel. We have to be moved to action. If we are the body, our hands have to be reaching to those that are lost. So this morning, if you want to be like Jesus, I want to ask you to show the compassion of Jesus to someone today. Would you pray with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the deep compassion that you had for every one of us. Father, Scripture is just filled with places where Jesus would see things and just feel hurt to the point of tears because he loved us so much. But he didn't just love us and walk away. He did something about it. And boy, did it cost him. He gave his very life because he loved us so much. So, Father, help us to share that same compassion with the people that we meet each day. Help us to realize and know, no matter how busy we are or how much we think we have to do, that if you put one person in front of us, that you expect us to show the compassion of Jesus to them so that they can see Jesus living in us. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus' great compassion for you caused him to leave his throne in heaven and come down to earth in the form of a man, and to sacrifice himself on that old wooden cross, to take our sins there so that we could be free from the burden of our sins and have everlasting life with the Father. If you have never received that precious, compassionate gift from Jesus, and you'd like to talk to me about that today after the service, I'd be glad to talk to you about everything that's involved with that and the wonderful blessings that come from it. At this time, we've got a video to share with you.
Before our usher team comes forward to receive our tithes and offerings and response cards, here's a few important things happening with our CE family. If you enjoy serving people well and care about the details that make a worship service run smoothly, then the usher team may be a right community for you to join. Ushers make a big difference together and set the tone for each service. Would you be willing to consider joining the usher team at your campus? If so, write usher on your response card to find out more. As our ushers come forward to collect our response cards and receive our tithes and offerings, giving your tithes and offerings to God through CE creates opportunities for people of all ages to gather together and worship, connect with others, and serve our communities. It's in these different environments all across our campuses that people regularly experience life change. Setting up automated giving is simple and quick. Our secure giving platform allows you to control the amount, frequency, and more. Automated giving saves you time and allows CE to plan boldly for the future. Establishing a weekly gift will make a huge difference, as weekly we are seeing lives transformed in Jesus' name. Thank you for being on mission with us to help more people experience a full life in Jesus Christ.
This is the day that you have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in your name, and now your joy awaits my praise. I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. When I was down, you brought me out. You set my feet on higher ground. So here I stand. You are my God, your faithfulness, my solid rock. I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done.
I had the best time today worshiping and learning with you. You may have made a commitment during the service, and if so, we'd love to have you reach out and let us know.
If you have any questions, comments, prayer requests, go to churchexperience.tv/connect or scan the QR code on the screen.
Want to get even more connected? Check out our CE social media, Instagram, Facebook, website, or app, or go ahead and hit that subscribe button right here. What a great day it's been. We cannot wait to see you again next week.